Is it on already?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, hello everybody. My talk is a little specific and it's mainly for the students. It's like my colloquium. Okay, so you can correct me and also comment me so that I can do a better work. The topic is the molecular breeding for Fourier disease resistance and high oleate content in groundnut. And the work what we have done in case of groundnut mainly deals with two traits, because when you talk of a crop, then you always talk of the traits, because there are a number of traits one can work on in a given crop. But the traits which we are looking at is the foliar disease resistance, and in groundnut, the moment if I say foliar disease resistance, then it refers to two types of leaf spots. One is the early leaf spot, and second is the late leaf spot, and also there is a rust disease. And also, in addition to foliar disease resistance, we are also working on high oleic trait to a little bit. That also I'm going to present in this talk. And LLS resistance is more quantitative and significantly influenced by environment and host. Of course, we are not working on ELS to a greater extent, but we are working on LLS and rust. And also, co-occurrence of LLS and rust results in defoliation, so therefore they are always almost associated. So screening for both these diseases is really challenging. And when there is a difficulty in case of, say, phenotypic selection, and if it is not so efficient, then usually the conventional breeding becomes less efficient. So therefore, we always talk of or think of molecular breeding in such cases. And in this case, I considered two phases or two stages of molecular breeding. One is the development of genomic resources like markers, identifying QTLs, all those things, and also validation of these markers, which is very, very important before those markers are taken for molecular breeding work. That I call it as the first phase. And the second phase is actual use of or utilization of those markers or QTL for plant breeding work. And that's what we have done. So these are the things which we have done in case of molecular breeding for foliar disease resistance in groundnut as well as oleate trait, and this comprises of both these phases, starting from development of mapping populations, development and validation of new marker systems, genotyping and extensive phenotyping, linkage maps and consensus maps, QTLs, linked markers, marker validation, and employing them for MABC, and development of backcross lines and interpolation lines, and then deriving various mutants out of these lines, and then bringing about or bringing the products which are in multi-location trial. So I would say that the molecular breeding is a complete story with groundnut, what I'm going to present now. So these are the various mapping populations, and that was the major advantage I had, because Dr. M. Isigaud had already developed several mapping populations at US Dharwad, and these are the mapping populations which were already available to me in 2009. And out of these many mapping populations, these two mapping populations were studied to a greater extent, that is TAG24 and GPBD4, and TG26 and GPBD4. And GPBD4 is the one variety which is foliar disease resistant, again developed by Dr. M. Isigaud in 2006. And this is highly resistant to foliar disease, and also they differ for different traits. And the advantage is we have got very high or large size real population. And in case of groundnut, there is a major problem with the markers. You take any marker, then the level of polymorphism is very, very low. And this is due to the narrow genetic base of the groundnut. You can find out that most of the markers are available or they have been developed in groundnut, but the level of polymorphism is very, very low. Maximum could be about, say, 7 to 8%. So therefore, we thought of developing a new marker system. Of course, I'll be talking about this transposable element marker systems in detail tomorrow, but just I'll give a glimpse of this one, the marker what we have developed in groundnut for the first time. And we have developed about 1,079 transposable element markers in groundnut, and also we have validated. And before that, of course, we gave the concept of the TE markers, and then a Japanese group came across with our work, and they developed about 1,000 markers, and then we developed again 1,000 odd markers. And the advantage is they are mostly intergenic and also genic, and also upstream, downstream, we know all the positions of them, and also we know whether genic or non-genic, so that they can be used to something called, say, gene tagging tomorrow. If the marker is known to be trait specific, then we can also know whether it's genic or non-genic, and also we can go for gene cloning later. And also we went for developing, say, CAPS markers, because in groundnut there are only two CAPS markers right now, but we have developed about, say, 500 CAPS markers, but we have already identified about 11,000 odd CAPS marker sites in groundnut across only 3 or 4 chromosomes, you can find out. The reason is, those are the 4 chromosomes which carry major QTL for the important traits which we are studying. So this is how we started the mapping, using transposable element markers, CAPS markers, SSR markers like this. When we started the work in 2010, this was the area. This is a specific region on A03 chromosome. There were only two markers. And this was the region which harbored the QTL for LLS resistance and rust resistance. And over the years, you can find out how the same region was enriched. We call it as marker saturation. So in 2010, this was the case in two populations. And in 2012, so we added another 3 markers. In 2016, we added some more markers. And in the latest marker, of course, is 2017 map also I have. There we included even TE markers. So that's how the same region over the years got saturated so that we can handle those QTL in a better way. And this is our latest publication where we worked on the construction of the maps for TAG24 and GPBT4, TG26 and GPBT4, and also we constructed a consensus map. And the beauty of this is the latest map which I was referring to. That's the same genomic region on A03 chromosome, which governs LLS resistance and QTL resistance, rust resistance. These are the QTLs which we have identified. And the indicator of our success that has come from a paper by Bertiol and his associates in 2016. When they sequenced the parental genomes of A and B genomes, Duranensis and Ipiensis, then they found that this same region has got one NBSS LRR gene, that's R gene. So through their sequencing efforts, they found that this region, whatever we said that there is a QTL for LLS and rust, they also identified an R gene, okay, indicating or giving some kind of strength for our work that we are moving in the right direction. And of course, we are also depending on SNP markers. These are the SNP markers. We have already genotyped various mapping populations. And also, this is the latest map we have for our mapping populations. You can see the number of SNP markers for A03 chromosome. And also, interestingly, we have got another mapping population derived from an allied variety called as TME2, which is very, very popular in at least 4 states of India. And also, there was one mutant which was derived from TME2, and that was EMS derived. And earlier, an effort was made to develop a RIL population, and the RIL size was 432, and we thought that is an ideal RIL population because the parents are wild types and its derivative mutant, so that the remaining background is highly common, and whatever difference is there, it is easy to capture the difference for the genetic factors. So therefore, to begin with, the RILs of TME2 and TME2 NLM make an ideal mapping population. That was our assumption, and the parents were studied for genic versus non-genic SNPs, exonic or intronic, synonyms or non-synonymous, and also copy number variations. These are some of the SNPs which we identified using double DD RAD sequencing. There were about 40 odd SNPs, you can find out, and also the genes were known in which these SNPs were found, and also we studied the copy number variations. Copy number variations were very, very minimum, and though we found about 3 or 4 copy number variations, none of them were significant. But the interesting part was, there was a lot of morphological difference between TME2 and NLM, though they were genetically almost same. morphologically they were different for various states, including say kernel size or the pod size, disease resistance, and also various nutritional traits. So therefore, we started genotyping these mapping populations using TE markers, transposable element markers, which we developed. So this is the map, the first map for this mapping population. And also we identified various QTLs for various states. You can find out, okay, these are the traits which we studied using this mapping population. And you can also find the R-squares for these traits. And also we took another route of GWAS using 300-odd genotypes from 48 countries. This is work done in collaboration with the ICRISAT. And we identified the QTL for various traits. Again, LLS, RUST, and the OLIA trait. Those are the our traits of our interest. And also we got important QTL for this these traits. And our interest was to look for this region on A03 chromosome. Say, for that, what we did is, we went for WGRs in resistant and susceptible varieties. The resistant genotypes are GPPD4, which is a derivative of this cross. Then VG9514, this is susceptible to foliar disease resistance or foliar disease. And TAG24, this is a variety from BRC Mumbai, that's also susceptible for the foliar diseases. And also we had near isogenic lines, which were, say, both resistant as well as susceptible types of NILs. And we compared the resistant genotypes versus susceptible genotypes and got about 2,77,000 SNPs. And also we sequenced the NILs, the bulks of NILs, resistant versus susceptible bulks. And again, we identified about 2,00,000 NILs, SNPs. But what was more interesting was there were about 14,000 odd SNPs which were perfectly co-segregating with the phenotype, that is disease resistance. And out of which 14,883 SNPs, they were harboring or they were present in this region, the specific region which we identified by mapping on A03 chromosome. So that gave us an additional confidence that we are in the right direction. And also, this region probably came from Arachis cardinaceae, because we had the data on WGRS, we could perfectly co-segregate, or we can find that that region comes from Arachis cardinaceae, which is not a diploid genome donor of cultivated groundnut, but it is a wild diploid. And wild diploids are known to, say, harbor the favorable alleles for many of the traits. So that's how we dissected out that region, the source of that region, and also the contribution of that region towards the traits. And also we worked out how many are having very high impact in terms of the phenotype or expression, and also how many have got moderate effect like that. And this was the R allele frequency. You can find out the rest of the chromosomes versus that region. You can see the small region, which is between 120 and 140 MB on A03 chromosome, you can find the frequency of R allele, very highly dense region, all carrying the R allele, very high frequency of resistant alleles. And also we took another approach to identify again the genes in that region. How many genes are present in that small region on A03 chromosome, and how many have direct relation with the phenotype. So for that, what we took is the QTL-seq approach, where we had a lot of reels, and from those reels, we identified several reels, made two bulks, resistant and susceptible, and then that was subjected for WGRS. And from that also, we identified the same regions contributing for foliar disease resistance, and also we identified about 26 genes in that region, and the functions were known, and some of the genes had direct role in foliar disease resistance. And then the most important part is, once we identify the QTL and the marker for a given trait, validation is very, very important before we take those markers or the QTL for molecular breeding work. And for that, because at US Dharwad we had a lot of collections of different genotypes coming from different sources, and we validated whether the markers, whatever you have identified, they co-segregate with the trait or not. So for that, we looked at various mapping populations, genotypes like that. And also interestingly, we had developed the heterogeneous inbred families, near isogenic lines derived from heterogeneous inbred families. That I'm going to highlight later. Say, We developed the near isogenic lines for the first time from heterogeneous inbred families in groundnut. These heterogeneous inbred families are nothing but they are the inbred families, but which show a lot of segregation, maybe in the advanced generations, maybe F5 or F6 like that. So we had some crosses like TAG24 and GPBD4, as well as TG26 into GPBD4, and when you looked at F5 or F6, we found segregation, especially for foliar disease. There were some plants in the same line which were resistant, and there were some plants which were susceptible. And then we made selections, and that we call it as near isogenic lines. And these near isogenics were derived from the heterogeneous inbred families, that is F5 line, not from back cross. So we made some selections, like, for example, there was one HIF, heterogeneous inbred family, and in that line, there were two types of plants, 14-1, which is LLS or rust resistant, and 14-2, which is LLS and rust susceptible. Okay, so that we called it as near isogenic lines because they came from the same F5 or F6 line. So similarly, we have got these many HIFs in this cross, and in this TG26 GP54, we had these many HIFs. So in all these HIFs, we made selections and we called them as near isogenic lines. And then we started whether the NILs, they can be used for validating the markers whatever we have identified. So interestingly, these near isogenic lines were same for most of the morphological traits. You can find out from this table that for pod yield, say for example 14-1 and 14-2, they were on par, okay, because the seed value is here. And also for test weight, but they greatly differed for the rust disease resistance. Okay, you can see that this is resistant and this is susceptible. Anything above 5, we call it as resistant. Anything less than 5 or more than 5, we call it as susceptible. So the meaning of this table is most of the near isogenic lines, they were same for most of the morphological traits except for disease resistance, that is rust resistance. And then we also try to check whether they differ only for those markers which are linked to disease resistance, and what about the background markers. So this is, so you can find out that this is for one of the background marker, that is AHT268, this is a transposable element marker. Most of the near isogenic lines, they are monomorphic. There is no difference. Means for a background marker, most of the near isogenic lines are same. But what about the marker that is linked to the trait, the disease resistance? You can find out. Many of the markers or many of the trait or many of the near isogenic lines, they differ for the markers which are linked to the trait. Okay? So where are the 14-1 and say 1 and 2, for example. Okay, 1 and 2, this was 14-1 and this is 14-2. That clearly differ for the marker which is linked to the trait, but they are monomorphic for most of the background markers. I have shown just for one TA marker which we used for background selection. So this is the kind of validation we did before the markers were used for marker-assisted breeding. So once we got the confidence that the markers which we have identified flanking to the major QTL, they are very good and also they are validated and they are really associated with the trait, then we selected those markers for marker-assisted breeding. So for marker-assisted breeding, which is the application part of the, say, genomics, then we took several recurrent parents which are allied varieties like GL24 and TME2. Hope you all know why I have chosen GL24 and TME2. And also ICGS76 and DH86. And also we took several donors. I'll tell you the idea. One is GPBD4. Second is several intraspecific derivatives derived from different diploid genomes. And also several introgression lines involving A, B, and K genome. K genome is in the form of Buttazikoi, Arachis Buttazikoi. And the reason why we have chosen several donors was because there was the phenotypic difference between these varieties. Say GPBD4, we always say that is disease resistant. But there are several interspecific derivatives which are still, say, resistant. Okay? They show higher resistance than GPBD4. So there could be some allelic variation at QTL locus. So therefore, we chose several donors. And also, we depended on these markers for making all sorts of selections. And these are the donors and the recurrent parents, which we use for marker-rest breeding. And these are different crossing schedules or crossing blocks or crossing plans which we did. I have given only the latest generations which we have developed. So in most of the cases you can find, either we have reached up to BC3 or BC4, and also we went up to, say, in all the cases, whether it's BC1 or BC2, went up to F7 or F8. So we maintained the backcross generations as well as self-root generations in the direct crosses as well as in the backcross generations. So these are the different, I'm not going to give you the performance of all the lines, but I'm highlighting only two lines which have been given for multi-location trial last year as well as this year. So these are the two lines which are under multi-location trial, because you know, while releasing a variety, the variety has to be tested under multi-location trial. And these are the two varieties which we have given for multi-location trial last year. We call it as DBG3 and DBG4. This is from JL24 and this is from TME2. You can see the resistance level as well as the pod yield when compared to the control. So this is the JL24 and this is the improved line of JL24, DBG3. And similarly, this is TME2 and this is the improved line of TME2, okay, which are under MLT, multi-location trial. And this is one center of multi-location testing, that is ARS Nippani, which is again northern part of Karnataka, where the testing is going on. And in addition to the foliar disease resistance, we are also working on the high oleate. Okay, our idea is to improve GPBT4, and there is one more variety which has been developed at our university, that is called G252, again, which is highly resistant for foliar disease. And we would like to improve the oleate content in these two varieties. And also, now we have developed several introgression lines or marker-rested bred lines in JL24 and TME2, which are already foliar disease resistance. So if we can improve the oleate content in those lines, then again it's beneficial for the farmers. So that's our idea. So therefore we have taken these two recurrent parents, and also we are using a special line which is developed in US. And we have got collaborative work with the collaboration with ICRISAT, and through that collaboration we got this mutant derived line, Sunolik. And the beauty of this one is it has got 80%, almost 78 to 80% of oleic acid. So therefore we have used this as the donor. And we made several crosses. Of course we are in the beginning of making the back crosses. We have reached up to only BC1, F1. And this is the oleic acid in F2 generations. Okay, we are yet to analyze the BC1 progenies and go for BC2. And we analyze some of the plants in F2. You can find out some of the plants showing very high level of oleic acid content. Okay, compared to the GPBT4, which has got only 42. G250 is also 42. Okay, whereas the Sun oleic has got 78.9. Whereas some of the F2 plants, I'm showing only those F2 plants which have got very high level of oleic acid. Okay, the highest oleic acid which we observed among some of the F2 plants is 64 in this cross and 65.5 in the second cross. And in addition to this one, we also went for introgression breeding, where we involved several diploid genomes. AB, of course, it's the diploid donor of cultivated groundnut. We also use the Arachis butterzoicoi, which has got K genome. So at ICRISAT, a synthetic amphidiploid was developed. It is IS-ATGR-5B by crossing Arachis magna, which has got B genome, and butterzoicoi, which has got K genome. And this is a synthetic amphidiploid. And you should be knowing how the synthetic amphidiploids are developed. And then we cross this IS-ATGR with DH86, which is susceptible to LLS and rust. And BC2 F7 introgressions lines were developed. And we evaluated thoroughly. And what we found is IL3 and IL4, they had very high level of resistance, even better than GPBT4. So therefore, we have been using them as the donors for our marker-rested breeding. Apart from that, we also went for mutation breeding in these two lines. Okay, so using gamma rays as well as sodium azide. And then this is IL3. And when we evaluated M2 and M3, we found several lines as well as plants, both susceptible as well as resistant. A lot of variability was created. That was the purpose, of course. And also we went for characterizing these mutants using DDRAD sequencing. And these were the SNPs which we found out. And see here, this is, sorry, this should have been IL-3. IL-3 and some of the mutants of IL-3. We compared in which gene or how many SNPs are there between the parent and the mutants. And also we can compare the difference between IL-3 and IL-4. And also some of the mutants of IL-4. It should be IL-4, not IL-2. And also, we got this kind of data from DDR sequencing. So number of SNPs between this, these are all the mutants, 1 to 8, when compared to the parent, that's IL-3. So for how many SNPs they differ? For example, the mutant number 1 differing from its parent, that's IL-3. Okay, 12 SNPs. Like that, we also went for number of chromosomes with SNPs, intergenic SNPs, how many are intergenic, and how many are genic SNPs, number of genes showing SNPs, that's also important, I'll show you, that indicates for those genes the mutations have occurred, and how many are non-synonymous. And this is for the second mutant, or second set of mutants from IL-4. And also we went into study the genes which have mutated in these lines. You can find out there were at least 5-6 genes which got mutated between IL-3 and its mutants and IL-4 and its mutants. And also functional annotation is done for most of these genes, but for, of course, some of the genes, the functional annotation is yet to be done. And also we went for checking the copy number variations between the mutants and its parent in both these cases. But we could not find any major copy number or significant copy number variations between the mutant and its parent. This is between the IL-3 and IL-4. And this is between IL-3 and its mutants. One of the mutants is compared here. And similarly, one of the mutants of IL-4 and the parent IL-4. No major CN copy number variations were found. And when the M3 generation was evaluated, then we found a couple of mutants which had very high level of resistance, and also the productivity was improved compared to IL-3 and IL-4. So this is one mutant which had got very high, significantly high pod yield when compared to the IL-3, and also it was resistant. Similarly, there was one mutant from IL-4 which was disease resistant as well as more productive compared to IL-4. Yeah, so this is our team, consisting of the PhD students, MS students, and lab assistants, and field assistants, and also our collaborators, the Japanese collaborator, Dr. Kenta Shirasawa, as well as our ICRISAT collaborator, Dr. Rajiv Varshney. Thank you very much for the opportunity and the patience here.
Thank you very much, sir, for the informative talk related to improvement of oleate and disease resistance using molecular approaches in groundnut. Now it's open for discussion. Please pose your questions for 5 minutes only.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it will go over. It's okay if there are any connections. No questions.
Good morning, sir. Yeah. This is Rajendra Roda from US Raichur. It was fantastic presentation it was. And my question was, what is the range of high oleic, medium, and low oleic content, sir? Is there any classifications or references?
Of course, I have the data. You can say it is almost equal. Okay, the category if you make, then we have all sorts of, mutants. In the F2 I showed, there were about 250 F2 plants. And if you look at the range is probably, I would say it is almost the same, because we have analyzed its own single plant data. Okay, the oleic acid measurement is done on single seed,
yes,
which is not so reliable in NMR. So therefore, we are taking that observation on couple of seeds which you can get from M3 generations onwards.
Okay.
So therefore, but now the preliminary observation says the kind of diversity or the variation what we get for oleic acid is almost same.
Okay.
if you make them into categories.
Yes, sir. And how can we say that this line is having high oleic? Means, what is the range of high oleic we can say? Means 45, means more than 65, or what is the range we can say, sir?
Okay. Say range. Of course, I have not come across with any that kind of range. But say for me, the yardstick is the best varieties available with us. Okay. Say GPBD4. Yes. I showed it is having about 42%.
Yeah.
Okay. So any improvement over that one is a real improvement for GPBD4 at least.
Okay.
So you can go up to 78%,
yes,
but getting 78 in GPBD4 may be a little bit difficult.
Yeah.
So anything more than 42, maybe 60%, because what we have in F2 is about 64%.
Yes.
So anything above that could be better than the check. Yeah.
And one more question, sir. We have identified earlier they have reported that GM2301 and SEC AD09, those are the markers,
yeah,
have been identified. Whether they are consistent with season to season, or they may vary for,
yeah,
season to season?
Yeah, it's a expression. Good question. Of course, I forgot to tell the phenotypic data what we have generated. The phenotypic data what we have generated for our 2016 euphytic paper,
okay,
is for 13 seasons,
yes,
starting from 2003 to 2016. Okay, so when we did the QTL analysis using the 13 years data, the same QTL were identified.
Yes.
I forgot to tell in my presentation.
Okay.
So therefore, I said it is exhaustive phenotype. In the title itself, I have shown. Okay, I think it is disconnected. So using the exhaustive phenotype, okay,
because
we have used 13 years data for identifying the QTL.
Because I came across with that marker, sorry, especially SEC AD09.
Yeah.
It was not expressed in the ICRISAT lab, only we are screened for,
correct,
the disease resistance.
Correct.
But it didn't express it there.
Yeah.
So I was confused.
Yeah.
For
so for this paper, we have used the phenotypic data from 13 seasons.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, sir. Thanks for your presentation. I have a quick question before they take your picture. With the heterogeneous inbred families, the one where you found the segregation for rust resistance with the F6s, was that a transgressive segregation, or did that match what you would expect with the parents of the original cross? Was it a susceptible by resistant cross? Did you understand? The question.
Are you talking of the near isogenic lines?
The NILs that you developed,
yeah,
out of the,
yeah, yeah,
the HIFs, the,
yeah,
heterogeneous inbred families.
Good.
Did the parents of the population, was it a susceptible,
no,
by resistant or just transgressive,
no,
segregation?
No, it's not by transgressive segregation. It's not by transgressive segregation. But among the RILs, we had some transgressive segregations. But those NILs are not transgressive.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. I would kindly request you to receive this memento,
okay,
and bouquet as a token of love and appreciation, sir. Thank you very much, sir. So now, we have one more speaker for the day, who is a very simple, very disciplined man of wisdom, and our own professor, who is none other than our Dr. Ravi Kumar, sir.
Sir, it's my privilege to call you upon the stage to deliver your talk, sir. Please, sir.
Thank you, Arpita, for the nice introduction. And everybody before me and yesterday, they spoke about their work, and they had their own data backup to speak. Unfortunately, I do not have anything, any data to speak or my work to talk about, actually. In fact, I am substituting for some other speaker actually. A few days back when Gangappa called me to give a talk, I was going through this paper actually. So I just thought, since I am addressing students, let me discuss this paper and this concept, which I also believe in actually. In fact, that's the reason why I have chosen this topic actually, and this article has come in Nature. All the plant breeders should go through this. So we know that conventional plant breeding mostly relies upon generation. A lot of people spoke about these things. We generate variability and we make selection. That is what is, till now, selection based on phenotypic variations. And when we look at this approach, see, for the past one century, we have been following this procedure, that is generation of variability and selection based on phenotype. And we are very, very successful in that, actually. This approach has been extremely successful. Remember here, the food problems, everything is solved mainly because of this approach. So provided a continuous supply of improved cultivars, a dramatic increase in yield in almost all the crops of the world, actually. So this conventional breeding has given us so much. So time after time, beating Malthusian predictions, actually. See, even now, about few years back, we were discussing the food production. We need about 270 million by 2020, etc. And we are reaching that, actually. And we are reaching that by using all this conventional breeding technology. Most of the food crops, at least in India, we do not have any transgenics. We are still following conventional breeding techniques, and we are quite successful in that. So according to FAO data, in less than 50 years, the world average of cereal yields has increased from 1.35 to 3.51 tons. Okay, that is again through conventional breeding, actually. Total production of cereals also has increased, but not much increase in the area under this crop. This all indicate the conventional breeding has been contributing. Thanks to new cultivars, like Green Revolution, etc., we also got new cultivars, new concepts, etc. So these impressive yield increase is due to adaptation of breeding innovations. So when I talk about breeding innovations, breeding is not static, remember here. So without this, I don't think I can move forward whenever I talk about conventional breeding and the food production, etc. That is Norman Borlaug. So one of the problem I would like to raise here is, don't you think our Indian scientists, at least team, who has worked on dwarfing rice, also deserve better recognition, actually, right? Isn't it? See, a person like Sachin Tendulkar, who plays for himself and indirectly for the country, actually, can be awarded with Bharat Ratna. Why not our team of scientists who have really solved the problem of world food, Indian food production, and solved food problems in India? Anyway, that's always a question which remains in our minds, actually. It's always lingering in my mind, always remember here, okay? So, and recently, I hope all of you have read this paper, Current Science paper, which is in our own colleague has written about this paper in Current Science. I don't know how many of you read this. If you have not read this, kindly go through this paper. This is very, very enlightening. So in the last few months, see, whenever in India, actually, whenever there is some innovations in engineering side or something like that, there is a big items in the newspapers. But remember, yeah, in the last few months also, so another remarkable feat in India, where a record of 310 varieties of agriculture crops were released for cultivation recently. And it is not a big news at all. There is no news about this in the newspaper, actually. So that is what is happening for the conventional plant breeders. Also remember here. See, all this food production increase, etc., it has happened gradually, and nobody is realizing the importance of that. So since we are producing 270 million tons, and nobody is realizing the importance of all these things. So with this background, I took up this conventional plant breeding. Actually, we should not forget about conventional plant breeding. So we could achieve all these things, improved production, or all those things, the targets we have reached, not because we have looked plant breeding in isolation, remember here. So we have accepted whatever that came in our way and adapted that in our class, conventional plant breeding program, so that the productivity or the efficiency as plant, of plant breeding kept on increasing, remember. Yeah. And genomic is also no exception, actually. And we are going to adopt that and implement in conventional plant breeding techniques. So another thing I would like to just point out at this stage is here. See, we talk about BT cotton, we talk about BT maize, we talk about many transgenics. So behind that, remember here, see, we know that whenever BT cotton was put in an inferior hybrid, so it was not very successful. That was one of the drawbacks when the BT cotton was introduced in the country. So the success of developing a good hybrid is again based on more or less conventional breeding with the assistance of many genomic tools, etc. So conventional breeding is going to stay and it is permanent, remember. So that's what I said. Plant breeding has adopted whatever the developments are that has happened in science. Remember here, we have also adopted biometry at one time, tissue culture, embryo, wide hybridization, all these things. Whatever the development that has happened in the other fields also, we have adopted in plant breeding so that we could grow. So many disciplines contributed for the growth of this plant breeding. So these are some, anyway, I have given a few general techniques we use in plant breeding. So this is just demonstrate that whatever has happened, whatever the developments that have taken place, we have adopted. So when the mutation breeding was introduced, actually, remember here, everybody thought then there is no need to make crosses. We can simply generate whatever the variability we have, and it will replace all other techniques. Mutation is God, really. When I was a student, people were thinking that you can create anything and can select anything, actually. That was the thing. And maybe during our student days, at least 80% of the thesis used to be on mutation breeding. Remember here, okay? So then what happened? So we have realized the hype that has created, that was created in mutation, and we know that it is a place in plant breeding technique, and we have simply introduced and integrated mutation breeding also with the plant breeding. That's how it is also become a part of our plant breeding techniques. Okay. Now going back to genomics now. So genomics is the next new area now. So it is also got, there are a lot of omics now, day after day they are coming out in papers, research papers, etc. And people are scared now. It may push this plant breeding and classical plant breeding or conventional breeding to the corner and it may dominate. Yes, it is dominating in the newspapers. Yes, it is dominating in scientific publications, etc. But that is not the reality. That's not the reality. Yes, it is going to play an important role in plant breeding, remember here. But plant breeding should be at the center. Not, it cannot be pushed to the corner. Okay. I'll come back to this. How we can feel that it cannot be simply pushed to the side, actually, okay? So there was two major projects for African drought maize, actually. It, both of them started with a huge funding in the year 2006, okay? One was led by CIMIT, another one is WEMA, from where the conventional, both the projects, they targeted using both conventional and also using GM techniques, okay? So the Gates Foundation is also funding both the projects. And in both the projects, their attempt was to develop drought-tolerant maize for African countries. Okay? And they have both the approaches, like both conventional breeding techniques as well as GMO technology. So targets that the projects, so when they have reviewed, actually, I have been following this project reports starting from 2010, actually. There are many interesting comments that come on the progress of these projects in the African countries. In the recent publications, okay, they have summarized the products of both the techniques. Okay, when I talk about conventional breeding, remember here, conventional breeding, 153 new varieties have been released in case of drought-prone areas of Africa. Okay, a large number of breeding lines. They say that another 20-25 years, people can work on this genetic material that has been developed and the inbred lines that they have identified and the varieties that they are using for crossing programs. In the field trial, at least equal to commercial seeds. Whenever the conditions are good, actually, it is giving on par with the commercial hybrid that are already being grown in Africa. Whereas all these, most of these varieties are the OPO, open pollinated varieties, as well as the hybrids, they are giving more than 30% yield under drought conditions. So remember, look at within 10 years, the impact of this thing, the seed industry of most of these 10 African countries has revolutionized, remember here. So more than 30,000 tons of seeds are produced in the last year in 13 African countries, and this is because of the introduction of DTMA products. Okay? And it has revolutionized the seed industry of all these countries. So 110 African seed companies, these are the large number of seed companies that have been continuously surviving on these products of the, and so many areas of area has been spread within 10 years. There's so much of area it has occupied, and it is spread. There is a prediction it will try. It will help in reducing the hunger by 9% in the African countries. Okay, this is the impact. It is. These are the varieties. These are the lines that have been developed using conventional techniques in through this product. This is one of the only one project, that is the DTMA project. Okay. And this many hybrids are there, this many varieties are there already in the field. So this is what the seed quantity, that is the new quantity, is due to new seeds are the, from the DTMA product. This is the quantity of more than 50% of the seed in produced in these countries is already from this new lines which have been developed through this project using conventional breeding techniques. Okay? You cannot ignore the conventional breeding techniques. Okay? So the two important projects, both of them, VEMA also has got a technique through conventional breeding also they have approached, and most of the VEMA, the genes or the inbred lines they have used is from the DTMA product wherever they have identified, and more than 200 unique germplasm lines or the varieties are there, varieties have been released for drought tolerance in the African countries. So this is like this is just to give an example how these seed companies, most of the seed companies are stacking this DTMA seeds, etc., and the varieties in the African countries, because they know that now the farmers are accepting these varieties and they have a market for these things. So for scientists now, based on this basic material, remember here, that has been come out of this through conventional breeding methods, etc., they are further developing and promoting improved stress tolerance varieties, and which are also going about 30 to 50% increased yield, particularly in case of low nutrient soils, etc., and aim to produce about 54,000 certified seed by the end of 2019. And it's not a big news, because they have already reached 30,000 quintals, and another 25,000, they are sure to get this actually. So next phase of CIMIT is to gear up towards reaching out the farmers. That is also essential. This success of this project, because also they have also reached to the farmers actually. Whatever they have developed, like in case of Green Revolution actually, whatever the varieties they have identified, they try to see that it has reached the farmers also. So that is another part, and they are trying to concentrate on this aspect of also. So researchers who bred these new varieties. Now, how did they breed these new varieties now? Remember here. See, I have told you, see, if you go through those articles, there are large and thousands of already lines they have identified which qualify for either for release or using as an parental line in their breeding programs or for any one of the stress, etc. How did they achieve all these things now? They have achieved all these things because they went back to germplasm, remember here. They have used the CIMIT germplasm extensively, actually, and they have used the CIMIT germplasm directly as well as in breeding using African varieties. So they have used this germplasm directly. Another interesting aspect of this, remember here, in the morning also Dr. Kuldeep Singh was talking. See, most of the old varieties, obsolete varieties, they have an immense value in case of allelic diversity for most of the stress factors. So that is the reason why there is a lot of functional diversity. So when I was going through some of the crops like red gram, pigeon pea, ragi, etc., there are more than already nearly about 100 varieties that have been under cultivation, released from 60s, 70s, 30s, etc. When you look at the functional variability in these varieties earlier released, which are obsolete today, I am sure you are going to get all sorts of genes for stress conditions. Because those were the varieties we did not concentrate at that time for stress parameters. We were only focusing on high yield, etc. That's the reason why they were all outdated, actually. But when you look at those things, they are all the resources for the stress tolerance breeding, biotic and abiotic stress tolerance breeding, and this is what this team did actually. They have used all the released varieties of the world earlier and screened them for drought tolerance, and they were very, very successful in getting drought tolerant genotypes. Okay, this is what we should also aim, remember here. So those who are working in crops, try to go back to your obsolete varieties and try to look for functional diversity. I am sure you will end up with good genotypes for the abiotic stress tolerance. Okay. Some of the old varieties in the bank were known to thrive in dry regions. Old and obsolete varieties in all the crops are rich sources for allele mining in the changes in area of climate change and breeding objectives. So we have changed the breeding objective, we have changed the climate change. Earlier breeding objective was higher yield, that's the reason why they became obsolete, right? Isn't it? When we are changing the breeding objective, it is essential to evaluate all those lines with the changed objective of breeding. Now with mass, it could be faster also, right? Isn't it? So coming back to see, this is the story about this project with reference to conventional plant breeding. They have also in the past 10 years, and maximum money has gone to this objective also to develop transgenics at the GMO for drought tolerant. And all of you know what is the story of drought card, right? Isn't it? All of you know what is the story of drought card. One maize hybrid has been developed by using CSP, right, isn't it? Okay. And I don't know how much area it has occupied. Till last year, I was trying to track that, maybe about 5,000, 50,000, something like that. Now, I don't think it is there in the, it's playing a major role in African agriculture now, this drought god. So hardly about, it is giving only hardly about 7%, whereas the genotypes developed through conventional breeding, they have reached, on an average, they are giving more than 20% of the yield advantage under drought conditions. So as Nature article points out, transgenic techniques which target one gene at a time have not been as quick to manipulate a trait like drought tolerance. So when you are looking at that, the trait of your interest, you should also look at the genetics. As breeder, you know what is genetics, gene to E interaction, etc. Whether your single gene solve the problem or not, you should be aware of these things. It generally takes about 10 times more money and 10 years longer to bring a biotech crop to market compared to conventional crop. So those who are interested students should also go through now. We have markers for salt tolerance, which are very good reliable markers. We have salt, we have markers for submergent tolerance. But go through the papers when the work was started, how the breeders have identified and pointed out and showed that there are major genes in that before going into the marker analysis also, without marker analysis also. So encouraged by the progress in DTM, in DTMA, CIMIT have also participating in the improved maize for African soils now. African soils are poor soils. Now people are also targeting, because conventional breeding has paid them very well, okay, paid them very well. They started using this conventional breeding techniques for poor soils also. So far, IMAS has developed 21 conventionally bred varieties for poor soils also. They hope to introduce these in 8 countries over the next year. There are also, most of the African countries also have problems like in India. It's very difficult to release the varieties. It's not very easy to release the varieties. Okay? So IMAS is also working to develop GM varieties, but they say these are at least 10 years from now success. So this for poor soils, GMO technique is also they are practicing in the case of IMAS, and they say that at least they are 10 years behind conventional breeding techniques. So Biswas Das, a maize researcher at CIMIT, says it is important to consider all the options. Yes, we should, as a breeder, we should consider all the options, right? Isn't it? Conventional breeding will probably have a greater impact. So conventional breeding has also been making important. See, even the GMO, it is not a solution because they concentrate only on major crops, whereas the conventional breeding one, in all these aspects, drought or poor soils, etc., there are many other crops they are also working, and in which the GMO people or the private companies are not very much interested. So nutrient efficient crops, next thing is that they have also targeted nutrient efficient crops. Huge worldwide potential for these traits. People have realized, companies have realized nutrient deficient crops where they can survive for low nutrient conditions or the low under low nutrition they should perform better, or poor soils, etc. So because there is a huge money, many companies are working on that. So plant biologist Alan Good of the University of Alberta in Canada, he spent a lot of many years to work on this aspect, that is for poor soils, particularly for pea uptake, etc. So work with companies also. He has also worked for many companies as an advisor GM crops that require less nutrient or poor soils, crops suitable for poor soils. So Good found transgene, alanine transferase gene from barley is working very well. He has developed a transgenic on them and he has transferred it to many crops. So he has identified this. He was working on the for a private company, and for a private company he has developed that strategy, and he felt that strategy is working very well for poor phosphorus soils, and he has also developed varieties using this gene actually. After that, he concluded that this approach has not been fruitful as conventional techniques are. It did not perform very well. They did not go further on this. So many genes involved in the nutrient uptake and use are. Also, there is also a lot of environmental variations. Now Good says, who has extensively worked on this aspect, says that if he had his time again, remember here, all the breeders listen to me carefully. Good says if he had his time again, he would put the lion's share of his efforts into conventional breeding approaches like those of CIMIT people they are doing. That's what he has concluded. So big corporations such as DuPont, Pioneer, etc., they are all working on this soils, etc. No fertilizer or transgenics are on the market. It would have a product available by 2020. DuPont, which is also working on this, they say that the product will be ready by 2020. I think I'm correct. That's what they say actually, okay? So although both of them have started simultaneously, both the approaches, the company says that the products are still in the proof of concept stage. We have heard many things about proof of concept stage, right? In the university and outside, always they talk about proof of concept, it will never go to the field many a times, right, isn't it? One good gene and expect major effect is unrealistic. Globally now, companies are reviewing their biotechnology initiatives in this area, particularly in the area of quantitative genetics, where large number of genes are involved, where large number of gene interactions are taking place. Meanwhile, researchers are trying to combine old-fashioned breeding with a variety of high new technical methods. Okay, now we should adopt new technical methods, like mutation breeding. We have accepted them as one of the breeding principles. Now we should also accept these new high-tech methods and try to incorporate in our breeding program, but without leaving the ground on basic plant breeding principles. Okay. So this is another case study. If time permits, I'll just continue actually. So, CIMIT, they have worked on, again, old school of thought, the conventional method for high phosphorus for low P soils. They have used the same, I have told you that private companies did not succeed in that, whereas this old school of thought, again, they have started with the help of CIMIT for low P soils. This is an interesting story, actually. He wanted to develop genotypes, particularly in case of bean, for low P soils, so that even under low P conditions, the crop should be able to take up P and survive and sustain, actually. What he did was, he carefully studied the root morphology, okay? He dug out the farms, fields, experimental plots, etc., and looked at that root morphology, which can contribute for high P uptake. So phosphorus tends to stick to upper layers of the soil. He has understood the mechanism. Phosphorus tends to stick to the upper layers of the soil, whereas the moisture is at the down layers, right? Isn't it at the below? Actually, so he has come out with a concept how the root should be for higher P uptake. That's what balanced roots close to the base of the plant that grow at a shallow angle. He has selected that trait, and he has also demonstrated that trait is contributing very highly for P uptake. So plants with long root hairs also took up phosphorus better and improved the bean yields by 89%. So these are the two parameters, root parameters, he has studied and he has taken. So combine both the traits together, they saw very much big progress. He has made extensive studies on root morphology, etc. Not in the pot culture, he went to the fields, he dug the fields and studied the root morphology, etc. And he came out with a parameter which is highly suitable for P uptake. Using these parameters, so roots from this is what the root structure is there. So the it's not going back. So he has characterized the root parameters. Before that. Next. So and he has selected the root sites, and he has published those root sites, and he has developed varieties using those root sites, and they are doing extremely well. They are actually giving 30% more yield, 300% more yield than the varieties that are there under low P conditions. Unfortunately, again, is unable to release those varieties, although they are in the pipeline of release, whereas China picked up his rights in soybean, and they have a large number of varieties which are already released using the root rights he has proposed, and they are being under cultivation. That is the area they have occupied. This is just to demonstrate, if you study the plant well, actually you can also develop varieties using conventional techniques. So similarly, he has also identified the root structure for low nitrogen efficiency in case of maize. In case of maize, he has identified the root rights which can take up nitrogen under low nitrogen soils, etc., low nitrogen soils. So there is a lot of characters he has shown. I'll just show the picture, what are the root rights he has selected. So this is the root rights he has selected. He has characterized those roots. Those who are interested can go through that. He has characterized some roots where it can perform well under low nitrogen soils. And he is also very, very successful in developing the maize varieties suitable for low nitrogen soils also. So there's some transport of nutrients in the root morphology, whatever you have identified. He has also characterized what is the structure of the roots for higher uptake of nitrogen. So this is what they have observed. So regulatory approval for 14 nitrogen efficient maize varieties. So he has also again developed a large number of varieties, and 14 varieties are in the pipeline for higher uptake of nitrogen or low nitrogen soils. Okay, this organization has more than 50 other varieties in the pipeline. Okay, so that is the greatest advantage of using conventional planting method. Apart from that, you will get a lot of genetic material to work with at later stages. So look at the last statement. I also tell my students, you should also look at the last statement actually. That's very good. I tell my students to go to the field. That's what Lynch said actually. I tell my students go to the field and just look at the plants and let them tell you what they are doing actually. At least particularly. See, that is what always as a teacher, I always tell you should communicate with the plant. The amount of time is spent with the plants will tell you what it wants and what genotype it has got. They should some sort of a bonding between a breeder and the crop species, whatever you are working with. So, and he has also developed high throughput techniques also to characterize. He has some simulated models. This is, he just wanted to make it. This is just some information. He has now simulated the root structure for pea soluble, like lower pea content, what is the root structure, lower nitrogen content, what is the root structure, and he is trying to apply them. Lynch is now using a computer model that stimulates the natural selection to work out what combination of root, because he has observed the root carefully, he has lived with the roots carefully. Now we can build up the models and say which are the roots which are suitable for the poor soils. Okay. And naturally with the advent of molecular markers, now we have an added advantage. Computer simulation models are there for the root which is suitable for that. He's also trying to develop molecular markers for those sites, and probably combining these two things, the efficiency of conventional plant breeding will definitely improve. And also in Kesav also there is a lot of research going on. There is some sort of an interspecific hybridization. I have not gone through this paper carefully. This is on the Google article. There is some sort of interspecific hybrids he has developed with different chromosome numbers, and it is doing extremely well, this Kesava actually. Okay. Now this is just to demonstrate all our classical, we should not ignore our classical methods, etc., interspecific hybridization, etc. So these are the advantages. Conventional breeding is cheaper and more effective. You should get a much bigger share. What's happening now, remember, yeah? Conventional breeding is cheaper and more effective. See, in spite of contributing, in spite of taking the production up to about 270 million tons, I felt very sad when A.K. Singh told he has to beg for funds, remember, yeah? That is the thing, actually. Yesterday, I hope all of you have heard his presentations. The person of such immense potentiality should not be deprived of funds. He should be allowed to give free funds, whatever he wants, and try to pursue his areas. So that's, unfortunately, it is not happening here. And those who are working in All India Coordinated Research Projects are also aware. So even in the All India Coordinated Project, if there are 5 scientists, equal share, they say. Whatever the grants that are released, if 1 lakh is released, 20,000 to breeders, 20,000 to agronomists, 20,000 to pathologists, something like that, they divide actually. It cannot be. Breeding activity is totally different. The number of germplasm we need to have, maintain, hybridization we need to do, the number of segregating population we need to grow is totally different. That's why extensive funding is to be there, even from the public organizations, to support plant breeding activities. So instead, only a small fraction of the ICR research budget is supporting plant breeding. So that's the reason why we are not very successful in cross pollination. In a crop like maize, it's very difficult without funds, remember here. The number of paper bags you want, number of labors you want is totally different. So that's the reason why there should be proper support for funding from this. Lack of support to handle large germplasm and segregating populations. This is another lacuna now. There is no support for handling large number of germplasms and segregating populations. We know that any cross, if you grow 2,000 plants or 5,000 plants, you are sure to get something, remember here. But what we handle in the campus or in the public sector, it's only 100 plants, 150 plants, etc. We don't allow recombinations to express, actually. So similarly, robust field facilities for phenotyping, and this is another lacuna with plant breeding, plant breeders, is that we did not develop facilities for phenotyping. So once we are now jumped to our objective is changed to biotic and abiotic stress tolerance, and we are not very much prepared. Conventional plant breeders, we are not very well prepared with the field facilities for all these things. Gradually, we should have grown along with this. When the objectives were changed, abiotic and abiotic stress, we should have prepared ourselves to have with all these physical phenotype, like field facilities to screen all these things. So there is nothing like field screening for any of these abiotic and abiotic tolerance or the stress tolerance actually. So main reason for success in maize is number of germplasm they tested and multi-location phenotyping. That's what the private companies do. The number of genotypes they test, and I was told they produce thousands and thousands of inbred lines before ending up with one of the best combination for the hybrid development. We talk in terms of 10, 1500, etc.
So use of wild species for allele mining and for major effect genes, etc. There are a large number of wild species. In the last two days, you are hearing about wild species and the major genes that are present, allelic diversity you get. So we have stopped using all these things in case of public sector breeding. We have not, most of the earlier breeding techniques, when I was a student, every breeder used to have his own germplasm, his own species collection, etc. Now nobody does that. There is another lacuna we have. We should now explore and use these wild species or the conventional varieties, old varieties, etc. in our breeding programs to develop. Combining genomic tools and mass in conventional breeding is very, very essential. We should always move with the time. We should always move with the time. We should always try to adapt these genomic tools that are being developed as the techniques to assist our plant breeding program, not to replace the plant breeding program, remember here, to enhance the efficiency of our plant breeding, conventional plant breeding techniques. It's not listening to me. So this is just to demonstrate whatever the wild species that they have used. I'll just run through these slides actually in the using conventional breeding technique. I'm talking about only conventional breeding techniques. So these are the wild species that they have contributed. So even for herbicide tolerance, we talk about transgenes. That I felt sad when A.K. Singh told in 1990 he proposed to develop a plant herbicide resistant tolerant genotypes. But unfortunately, this idea was turned down by the committee members. You know what? What are the type of people who sit in the committee members? Committee also we know. So crop wild rivalries are a source of variation for many traits of interest in breeding, in particular tolerance to biotic and abiotic stresses, intragressomics. There is a new term. See, another thing is also plant breeders also should be smart actually, remember here. Okay? We should also coin some new terminologies. Okay? They have coined recently one intragressomics. Okay? Omics is the one which is moving now. We should also coin some terms. Intragressomics, which consists of mass scale development of plant material with introgression from CWR, introgression from a preempt. That's a very important for any basic material, to develop any basic material for breeding. So plant breeding is highly dynamic science, allowing the incorporation of new tools and resources to address the new challenges. So conventional breeding is certain, but it is relatively slow but very successful process in resulting genetic material. Genomics allows, so genomics is very thing, that's a very slow process. Conventional breeding is relatively slow. By application of this genomic techniques, etc., we can hasten the process or we can speed up the process of plant breeding or the selection process, etc. So detection of new alleles in natural germplasm, all these things, these genomics tools have a lot of applications. If you want to look for new alleles, etc., like Ramesh Bhatt was looking at different alleles at using NSSNP, etc., like that, you can also look at different alleles using these techniques. So this is what I want to end here, actually. Omics, we should adopt, remember, in a big way in plant breeding, but it cannot replace conventional plant breeding. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Your speech was more like a feast for all the conventional breeders assembled here. Thanks for reminding about the importance of conventional breeding to all the present and upcoming breeders, and about how the genomic tools should be appropriately used to supplement conventional breeding. Thank you very much, sir.
Now it's the time to ask questions to Dr. Ravi Kumar, sir.
Very good afternoon, sir. So I am Dr. Ramakrishnan from Loyola College. So actually, I am not eligible to attend this conference because I am the biotechnologist. So as the sir told.
No. Before you complete, I belong to biotechnology department. by degree, I am in genetics and plant breeding. Actually.
Not like this, sir. I'm a biotechnologist. So really, my very much interest in the plant breeding and genetics. You told like the plant breeders as the director of the movie. He only decide the stories and the heroes. Then the story will be success. You told the right path of the plant breeding and genetics. What I'm saying to that, we should make the awareness among the biotechnologists who the plant breeds, the importance of plant breeding. Then we make the collaboration with my questions. What is the ratio between biotechnologists and plant breeding and genetics?
What is the
ratio, the collaboration ratio between the plant breeding genetics and the biotechnologists? Because the people are thinking who are working in the biotechnologists is simply in the genome editing, okay, the output that directly they are putting in the variety, new varieties. it is not easy. We should approach the brother and we make the right, and these are the factors. So my question is, my conclusion, please make the awareness among the biotechnologists, the breeders are the most important to release the varieties.
No, actually, I tell you, I am not discounting biotechnology. Biotechnology has its own application, like BT cotton or whatever it is. That's own implications, actually, right? Isn't it? Another thing I just want to tell biotechnology, because I am in biotechnology department. So if you forget Mendel, there is no point in doing biotechnology. But I feel, I am in biotechnology students, other than genetic students, they try to understand, they should understand Mendel first. Then probably all your plant breeding, wherever you applications of biotechnology will realize.
Yes, sir. First, in my state from Tamil Nadu, there are many scholars, they do not understand what is the importance of the plant breeding and genetics.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, I am Raghavendra from UHS Shumaga. I am Raghavendra from UHS Shumaga. It was a nice presentation, sir. So whatever the recent techniques in the molecular breeding may come, the ultimately the performance of a genotype in the field is the one what we needed. Okay, sir. By seeing all these things in the publications in the different high-end journals, so what I am thinking is the conventional plant breeding is more of product-oriented and molecular breeding is more of towards publication-oriented. So what's your view, sir?
No, I have Dr. Krishnamurthy is here. Dr. Krishnamurthy is here. Dr. Krishnamurthy, who has worked extensively using only on breeding techniques, okay, look at his publications now. See, it is the science you apply is very important, not the techniques, remember.
Sir, but we see very rare journal, very rare papers
of conventional. No, because there is no science in what you are doing. So you should do science. You should do science. See, you need not use molecular techniques to do science. Take it from me. So then you can...
Excuse me, sir.
Sir, please receive the memento. It is the token of love from our department. Thank you very much, sir. We are proud to say that we are the students of most enthusiastic, charming beauty spot of US Bengaluru, the most inspiring woman to all the girls, of course to the boys too. So maybe now you might be all knowing, yes, it is none other than our beloved professor and our Dean PGS, Dr. Shailaja Hittalmani.
Ma'am, I'm pleased to be with you today. Please come over the stage and throw the light upon the topic, highlights of the finger millet genome.
Anyway, we are very late for lunch. I'll wind up quickly. My talk will be more of an information to be given to the students rather than, there is not much science, Ravi Kumar, in that. And the blue shirt biotechnologist, where are you from? Okay, because you are wearing blue shirt, you are eligible to ask a question. So there is no doubt about it. And you have some misconceptions, you clear it during the lunch. Because you're talking about biotechnologists. Every scientist is doing biotechnology in every field of agriculture, except a few social scientists who are also doing impact of biotechnology. So they are in touch with what is biotechnology and how it can be applied to the field. So there's not much deviation from both. They are going hand in hand. With this, this topic actually came as a surprise when Gangappa asked us to present this, because this was one of our pioneering work from US Bangalore, I can say. So many of us don't have awareness about this work was done at US Bangalore, because when in India the first work about sequencing came up with rice sequencing, only half of the chromosome was given to India, I think many of you know, to IARI, and they got half of the 11th chromosome of rice and sequenced, and then that became a big news because that was the first crop to be sequenced after the model crop of Arabidopsis. And all of you know it took several years to sequence the rice crop across several countries across the globe, And now it has become very common, and still it is not so easy to do the sequencing because of so many other factors. So this one was our latest sequence that we developed from US Bangalore. And US Bangalore takes the credit, and India also takes the credit for sequencing this ragi crop, which is the native crop of Karnataka. So I wanted to tell, so that people should know, no, when you boys and girls go outside, you will not know this work was done at US Bangalore yourself. So many of the research work done at US Bangalore goes uncredited. I'll tell you, in the accreditation committee, in the accreditation of the universities, our vice chancellor and all the officers, they were telling US gives only about 50 to 60% of the information, all of the work done, and that's why we have got lower ranking this time. So if I think we would have got first rank this time, other than IRI and all those institutes, because we are not providing correct information, correct number of papers, number of scholars, number of scholarship, as much as they are, actually. So that's one of the reasons also. So this effort came from, in 2012, we started the work with the remnant funds of one of the projects that I was offering, was operating from the McKnight Foundation, USA. That was a finger millet development project, both conventional, farmer participatory breeding and varietal development. So, next, Marthira. So in this project, our main aim was to develop a new variety for drought and blast tolerant, and through which we developed a variety called ML365, which is now popular in the zone 5 of Karnataka, and it has occupied about 50% of the GPU28 variety, and for blast resistant and drought. In 2011, when there was severe drought, this variety was one of the only ones survived when there was no rains for more than 2 months. And farmers were very happy, and the fodder yield also is very high. And it is also preferred by the cattle. And this variety was developed through farmer participatory breeding right from selection of the parental material, and then tested in a farmer's field right from F1, F2 generations, and so it was well accepted. I think regarding ragi, I need not give much explanation. These are the two species available, and which we used, and I'm not able to see properly. Okay, so we'll go to the next. The important, please go back. So we used this, and the highlight was, these are the highlights. It's allo tetraploid, and high amount of calcium and amino acids are present. And fiber is one of the main criteria why ragi is successful in medical field also. Then it has a C4 synthetic pathway, and that's how it gains more resistance. And next one, please. So this was the program of how the variety was developed, right from crossing to the cooking quality testing, and also farmers' participation in every activity. We covered almost 7 districts of Karnataka, zone 5. Then next, please. I'm coming to that topic on sequencing. So the first thing we had to do to sequence was ploidy estimation, because there are several reports of finger millet where exact ploidy is not known. So without knowing ploidy and without knowing the parental combination, we couldn't go ahead. A genome is their indica, but B genome, even till today, it's not predicted. Several reports say several, but till today, even after sequencing, we were unable to tell what is the B genome of the ragi. And so we did the ploidy estimation using flow cytometry. And if you can see from there, we used the different genomes, indica, with the diploid and tetraploid species. And you can see the last column there, 1453 digit. Number is 1.4 gigabytes, or 1400 MB it is, 1400 MB is the size of the genome. Actually, in report, it is 1500, but we got this type. So when we did actual estimation with taking soybean as the, garden pea, I think, no? Mahesh? Garden pea as the standard. So first we estimated the ploidy. So there was some match between diploid and tetraploid. And then after confirming that, and we went in for sequencing using different platforms. The next one, please. Next, yaar kailide? Okay. So this was the methods we followed in de novo sequencing using different platforms. So you can see this is a standard way of estimating the DNA sequences of any crops or any species. Earlier to this, we went in for where is our rice? Actually, there is some missing. Next, okay. Run the slides. There are some slides missing. I don't know why. Save agilla. Okay, I will I'll go back. What I wanted to say, I'm sharing this presentation with Dr. Mahesh, my PhD student, and who was responsible for doing some of the rice sequencing, which the slides are missing, and also. He took the major responsibility of sequencing and also doing the bioinformatic works. He sat with the company, Genotypic, and he was day and night he was sitting with them and finding out what we want, because they do standard, run the DNA and they give the standard data, which we didn't want. We wanted to focus on the drought as well as nutraceutical type of genes contributing to that. So he will present this actual sequencing. Earlier to this, I wanted to tell you which slides are missing. We also sequenced Sarocladium oryzae, the fungus that causes sheath rot in rice. That was also the first report from US Bangalore. This is for the information of the students I am telling. Then, during the PhD thesis of Dr. Mahesh, who is now a SERB DBT fellow and a postdoctoral fellow, of DBT, and also he's a big grant winner of 50 lakhs, and he's working partly with NCBS and some other institute. Hopefully, good things will happen to him, because he's a highly trained person in this field, and very few are actually in this area. So that was one, sheath rot fungus, and secondly, we sequenced 7 local rice varieties, whole genome sequence, and also 226 local rice varieties by RAD sequencing. These are all the pioneering efforts that happened in genetics and plant breeding department by a PG student with the grant from Monsanto Beechel Fellowship. So we read other universities and in the world where they do all this kind of work, and there's a great publicity. But here, because you students have gathered, I wanted to tell you, we have whole genome sequenced all the local varieties, found what kind of functional genes are there, what kind of disease resistant genes are there. This morning both Kuldeep and who else, Hanchinal, were telling about we should characterize the germplasm and identify and tag them with the traits, which genotype has what trait, and then we can use them in the breeding program. So this genome sequence itself gives directly what genes are there and their sequences and their functions. Also, so this work has been done in rice using the local collections that we have here. There are several, but we have done a portion of it. So that's one aspect. And then we have also characterized the blast fungus, which is a small genome compared to rice or finger millet. And it has given several key genes wherein we can use it for future studies, where we can make the crop resistant or susceptible or shut down genes and things like that. It goes as a future work, actually, because we have prepared a base where this information can be used for various purposes later. Like someone questioned just now, what is the use of going for molecular work? As a breeder, we know the importance of both. So some can be used immediately and some can be used later. later. It happens in medical field. Genes are discovered, medicines are discovered, but at some point of time they become very important. So both conventional as well as molecular help at different times. So now, because some slides are missing, sorry for that. The finger millet genome sequence, Dr. Mahesh will just present, because it's his work. I want him to make it more clear to you. So please.
So good afternoon. Myself Mahesh. Sorry if few slides were missed. This is the fourth genome from US Bangalore. Before this, we had a first Indica rice genome from this country using both second and third generation sequencers. So I'm happy to say that is a part of my PhD work. And the second genome was Saracolidium, which is a fungus which causes sheath rot in rice. So that is also first report in the world. In addition to that, the third genomes were like Magnaportha genomes, this Magnaportha fungus, which infects both rice, ragi, and millets and grass species. So what we did was we isolated this fungus from these three, across these species, and compared their genome, what kind of secretory elements are there with respect to, the species deviation. So with this brief introduction, so we took two different approaches to sequence this ragi genome. So one is genomics approach, the second one is transcriptomics. These two were done in parallel. So first initially we developed the genomic sequences from using Illumina and Solid. In case of Illumina, we used both paired end and mate pair sequencing technologies, and high quality reads were assembled using SOAP de novo tool, and these assembled sequences or contigs were further refined by using SSPACE tool to improve the assembly. So this improved assembly was subjected for gene prediction using Augustus. During gene prediction, what we did was we also sequenced the RNA sequencing of two libraries. One was well watered and one more was low moisture stress. So these RNA sequencing reads were assembled into transcripts. And these unigenes or transcripts were inputted to the Augustus to predict the gene models. So after gene models were predicted, so around 85,000 genes were predicted, and we segregated them into non-TE and TE related. The TE means transposable elements associated genes. And so after that, we functionally validated we did a functional annotation using InterproScan. So in addition to that, in parallel, we use this improved genome assembly to predict the SSRs. Next. So we predicted around 85,000 genes in finger millet. So our interest was how these genes were conserved across Poaceae species. So for that, we retrieved the gene sequences of rice, foxtail millet, and Brachypodium, and sorghum, and maize. So we clustered all these genes using ortho-MCL tool. So interestingly, around 10,291 genes, that means those many core ortholog genes were found across these six species. So also 18,150 genes were unique to finger millet. So when we did ortho-MCL clustering, we found around 799 genes which are single copy genes which are shared across these six genomes. So those are very essential genes, because during the evolution, these crop species were retained only single copies. So we took those genes to build a phylogeny. So based on the 766 single copy ortholog genes, so it is evident that finger millet is very close to rice, followed by foxtail millet. So also we used the whole genome information of the ML365 genome to identify the syntonic blocks across these five species. So we compared the genome sequence of rice and finger millet, and also genome sequence of finger millet with Brachypodium and foxtail millet, maize, and sorghum. So it is observed that the world, like across these species, there are several, conserved syntonic blocks were observed. So this signifies these species are closely evolved during the process of evolution. So as I already said, we use this ML365 genome to identify the SSR markers. So around 1,14,000 SSRs were identified. Among them, so di repeat types were major, fraction, followed by tri repeat and tetra repeat. So what we did, we predicted all these SSRs in this ML365 genome, and also we did a in silico validation using EPCR technique. Whatever we have predicted is accurate or not. So most of the, around 20 to 30% SSRs were, removed because of false positives during the in silico prediction. And we took, ample amount of SSRs to validate in wet lab. So for this, we used around 34 finger millet accessions, which are acquired from All India Coordinated Project on Small Millets, along with ML365. We validated using agarose gel electrophoresis and also PAGE. So what we observed was, when we used agarose gel electrophoresis, so the polymorphism level was very low. So the same thing we have reported in our paper, that so in case of finger millet, the polymorphism level is very low. So we suggested to use a PAGE gel. So, and also we know that finger millet is a drought resistant, climate resilient crop. So it has inherent that drought tolerance mechanism. To know that, what we did was we grown ML365 crop, plant in well watered and low moisture stress condition, and we sampled the RNA from both the conditions and sequenced using Illumina sequencing technologies. So when we did this RNA sequencing technology across, between these conditions, so most of, around 4,859 genes were upregulated under moisture stress conditions. So these genes could be a candidate genes in future to, impart drought resistance in finger millet plant breeding and variety development. And also we checked the PFAM, protein family domain associations of these genes, and most of them were protein kinases and protein kinases, tyrosine kinases and BTB bar POG domains and UBOX domains. So these domains were responsible for drought tolerance in finger millet. So, and also one more interesting thing was, this is my personal interest in fact, so mining the transcription factors in any genome. So we mined the transcription factors in finger millet genome also. So it shows that around 11,125 genes composed of these transcription factors. So we mapped all these transcription factors to know the, majority portion of the transcription factors in the ML365 genome. So it shows that most of the genes have BHLH, basic helix loop-like structures, and MIP transcription factors and Warkey transcription factors are the major transcription factors in the ML365 genome. And when we went back to the literature, so most of these transcription factors are involved in drought tolerance. So with this, so we developed a whole genome sequence of ML365 or ML365 ragi finger millet variety. So what next? So with these genomic resources, we can use, as the whole genome sequence can be used to study the synteny across n number of species, whatever you want, to retrieve the genomic, syntonic blocks between the crop of interest. And also we can study the evolutionary mechanism, how these crop species have evolved. And also the orthologous genes, what we identified across 6 species, can be used to, discover the QTLs using orthologous approaches. And also 1 lakh plus SSRs, whatever we identified, can be used in diversity studies and linkage map construction. The linkage map construction is next task, because we don't have a good linkage map in finger millet. And also, these SSR markers can be used in QTL mapping or association mapping studies. And whatever the genes we identified in finger millet can be used in gene cloning, like especially drought tolerance genes can be cloned, and you know, we can transfer to any other orthologous species. And also genes can be used to mine the alleles, and also gene editing technology can be used to impart drought resistance or disease resistance, whatever you want. And also these genes can be used to design markers, and you can use them in marker assisted selection breeding program. And also one more thing is RGAs, resistant genes analogs. So as I earlier said, like the Magnaporta infects both rice and finger millet. So whereas in case of rice, there are 22 plus genes have been cloned so far in rice. So most of them are like in NBS, LLR and coil domains. So you can search those genes in the Ragi genome, and you can find the resistant genes analogs in ML, like Ragi genome, and could be used in R gene mapping in ML3 Ragi. And also transcription factors mining. So I already told like 11,000 genes have, these transcription factors. Those could be, cloned, and you can study, you can use them in development of GMOs or overexpression of these TFs to impart the broad spectrum resistance or broad spectrum drought tolerance. So this study was recently published just 3 months back in BMC. So BMC Genomics, and I already got 3 citations, and also we are receiving so many emails from the researchers who are working in the same line of research. So morning also we received one email from a Chinese scientist. He wanted to mine the transcription factors in finger millet, and he want to make a catalog and upload in Cornell University transcription factor database. And also we released this whole genome sequence and gene information in the NCBI database. So now anyone can access with this genome sequence access and ID. And also this was, also came in the news. So in the Hindu at a national level. So with this, let me conclude. So this is the first report of whole genome sequencing. And also we estimated the genome sizes of both cultivated and wild species. And it is, what we assembled was about 82% of the total estimated genome, that is around 1.19 GB. And based on the genome assembly and annotation, we identified around 85,000 genes. And one more very interesting thing when we were doing analysis was repeat content. So this finger millet genome is highly repetitive, and 50% of the genome is repetitive. So that posed a lot of problem during genome assembly. So and also, based on the orthologous analysis, we found that higher collinearity was observed with foxtail millet and followed by rice. And also, based on the RNA-seq experiment, so there are large number of drought tolerance genes were identified, which could be used in further drought resistance breeding. And also, we have identified several R genes based on the PFAM domains, and also calcium transporter genes, because this finger millet has 3 times more calcium than milk and 10 times more calcium than any other cereal. So obviously the whole genome sequencing information developed from this study will obviously help the future plant breeders, especially finger millet plant breeders. So acknowledgements, so this work was initiated in 2012 with the available, partly available money from the McKnight Foundation. And then we got a full-fledged funding from Sujala, Watershed Development Government of Karnataka. And also we thank All India Coordinated Research Project on Small Millet to give us finger millet accessions and also wild species. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your dynamic talk. And also, I thank Mahesh, sir. Ma'am, please, you also come. You also come. Thank you, Mahesh sir. Ma'am, you are the role model for many plant breeders. Thank you.
There is some coincidence here. Come here. He is my MSc student currently. He is a passed out student.
Thank you. Thank you. I know that you all are very hungry. It's time to break for lunch. Lunch is arranged in Suvarna Raitha Bhavan. We have an arrangement for bus also. Please assemble here at sharp 3 o'clock. Please.